This podcast is brought to you by LMU Munich.
Thank you very much. So let me repeat my final part of my last lecture. It's about derivation of this holographic entanglement formula. So just we explained about the replica calculation of this holographic derivation of this entanglement entropy. So basic formula was this replica method. Is this one in terms of partition function of Zn. And Z1 is a standard partition function of some manifold, which we are looking at. Zn is this n-seated version of the manifold. And we want to compute this partition function and take this difference and take derivative n. And in Zn, we set n equal 1. And what we saw yesterday, that this part is given by some smooth manifold. And its n means that if we go to this tau direction, which is the replicated direction, we are talking about replica method. So in 2D, we have some n-seated Riemann surface. And we go this around. If we go around once, it's 2 pi, and another 2 pi. And so in the end, you get 2 pi n. So this tau runs from 0 to 2 pi n. So this angle is 2 pi n. But still, we adjust the metric so that this part is smooth, like metric is like this, dr square and r square divided by n squared dc d tau square around here. So it's actually same as the situation which we have in the polar coordinate. So this is a smooth manifold, but minus some conical manifold, because this is conical because z1 is just regular partition function on a smooth manifold, but we did this multiplication n, we multiply n, that means this angle is again 2 pi n. So for z1, we just have regular configuration, which is a 2 pi, but we have to multiply n along this type direction, it's become singular, it's a cone. But we don't need to take into account any no boundary contribution. Boundary contribution means that we treat this part as a boundary, and for example, put some Gibbons-Hawking term and regulate the theory. But we don't need to do that. Just we take a copy of this regular partition function. But here, it's a really smooth calculation. But because of the Einstein equation, we can just forget about first order deformation. We can just focus on this difference between which only different. This two manifolds only different near the tip, only this region. So here it's just singular, just conical, but here it's smoothed up, it's capped off geometry. And then we can use the standard AdS CFT, which means that partition function, log of partition function is just minus of gravity action. And we know that gravity action is in Euclidean formulation minus 16 pi g Newton, and integral of g and some Ricci scalar and some cosmological constant, and sometimes we have matter field, but they don't contribute. And at this point, the difference comes from this part, mainly comes from this part. And this r here takes this form. So this difference, you can show this difference takes this form. So when n equal 1, this is just cancels out. These guys cancels out. This means 0. So it should be proportional to 1 minus n. And this leading contribution is actually localized on this tip. This gamma a is just here. I just mean this point. But it's extended in transverse direction. So it is a codimension 2 surface. But in this language, just two-dimensional manifold language is just point. It's just delta function localized. So this can be obtained very easily. So you can just consider some smooth manifold and just take limit whether this becomes shrink to slightly cone-like shape. But then you can easily derive this formula. So I just don't derive this formula here. But this is just because of this deficit angle, which is like 2 pi 1 minus n here. N is actually larger than 2. So actually, larger than 1, so this is negative. So this is negative deficit angle, but it's just like call it deficit angle. And then we know the Ricci scalar. gets a delta functionally divergent at this conical point. And we just, in the end, we just evaluate this gravity action. So we just plug this here in. And this, as you can easily see, this, we get 4 G Newton here. This cancels out. And this minus sign appears. So it cancels out. So n minus 1 times. So it's localized on gamma A. That means we have area of gamma A. It's just the integral localized on the surface. And we, in the end, we plug here this formula and just compute this one. And it is very easy to see that in the end. So we have minus sign here and also minus sign here. And they cancel out. And we just take derivative of n. So we just have this area of this gamma A and 4 G Newton. But here, actually, we should say about gamma A. For that, we can just require this equation motion. So require this gravity equation motion. And that means we should take some stationary value at assuming this background. So this means that actually this area also extremalized. So this is a condition of minimal area surface. This is a very basic logic how to derive this entanglement entropy formula, which is just this form. And with this gamma A, is interpreted as a minimal area surface, which whose boundary it looks like just coincides with the boundary of A. It's like gamma A is like this, and it minimizes it.
But that picture you have gamma A is.
Sorry? Gamma A is?
In the picture over
here, yeah.
Yeah,
I don't, only in the tip, yes, yes. This is a codimension two. And it's extending transverse direction. Yeah, yeah. So I just cut it out particularly. We just take this tau direction is something going around this entangling boundary. And we just write this kind of manifold here. So it's really 1 point here. So, okay, so these are classical calculations. I just want to briefly mention what happens if we take into account the quantum corrections. I'm basically focused on this one loop correction to this entropy. I'm following the work by this work done by Faulkner, Lukowitz, and Maldacena. And also there are very interesting calculations in AdS3 by Varela, Don, and Hartnor, and Martin. So here, I just mentioned some generalization of this result in terms with taking into account these quantum corrections. But their conclusion is very simple. I just here explain. So here, we had this manifold. Anyway, important point is the partition function on this manifold. But this has some problems that when integer, n is not integer, then this calculation is not that so clear because we are talking about non-integer copy of this manifold. So we can just look at, so this 2 pi n manifold is just, we can just n copy of just regular manifold, which actually is singular, 2 pi, with this metric. And we just here define this manifold nn. This we just define mn, and we can just call it mn hat. And the basic idea is that so we divide this mn hat pass integral in terms of, you know, this is a gravity calculation. We have in mind gravity calculation on this and take into account one loop effect. So this is interpreted as some Hamiltonian which is going around this 2 pi direction, this tau direction. So we take this time, tau to be a real time, we just assume that. Then we can always express this way. Some this Hamiltonian can be non-local, but we can just write this way. So this is some time evolution in this direction. And this defines the density matrix for this bulk evolution. So this is defined to be bulk density matrix. But here we background field is assumed to be periodic about 2 pi. So we just integrate from 0 to 2 pi. And that is, we are talking about quantum fluctuation, that the quantum field is included in this Hamiltonian. And so in this quantum corrected level, gravity partition function, which we want to compute this, exactly this one, it's, and with this MN, then, it's written in terms of this bulk, this operator, this bulk density matrix to N. Because it's N, because we have to cause N copy of this, and N multiple of this. This originally we want this one. And this is also this good, well defined. There are no N here, and just we have 2 pi. But this H star is actually, we have to respect the metric, which like, as I already written, so it is N dependent, so that we have a smooth geometry here. So this is actually N dependent. But we don't have to worry about this range, it's just 0 to 2 pi, which is regular calculation. And by using that, the claim is just very simple. We just compute this quantum corrected entanglement entropy is just given by computable by looking at this quantity. Basically. And we take n goes to 1. Of course, it's a very tricky to how to compute this, just this general prescription. And I don't know how to compute in general. It's quite hard, difficult, this calculation, but at least we can some formally represent the calculation in this form. So one comment is that, I mean, this we have to take derivative of n. So if we take derivative of this n, then we just get the standard formula of von Neumann entropy. And that part corresponds to this bulk entanglement. Bulk entanglement means that we just fix background, we just fix metric and as a scalar field, and just talk about this one loop diagram around that. So bulk entanglement entropy, something. So this is appears in the context of black hole entropy, and people try to understand black hole entropy in terms of entanglement entropy. In that context, people compute entanglement entropy between black hole horizon and outside. So that corresponds to this part, but in this holographic calculation, actually we have another part which comes from this derivative. Derivative about this dependence on this background, derivative of this background n here. That gives some additional contribution. So this is roughly something like world-like contribution, world formula, you can imagine some world-like contribution. For example, we can talk about this phi square r coupling in supergravity, and at the quantum level, phi square takes some expectation value. So this becomes non-vanishing, and because of the presence of r, we can use the same argument here. We have some pick up some contribution because of deficit angle gives this delta function. That contribution is hidden here. And also we have some counter term and contribution. But roughly this is a sketch of what we have in quantum correction. But it's quite, in general, it's quite hard, I should say. Sorry? Sorry? Ah.
I just want to understand where can you just remind.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, classical part is, I mean, just come from this classical evaluation of classical action. Okay. And we just do replicatory. And we are talking about a one loop correction, which we pass integral over fields around this representation. That is what we are doing here. It's a pass integral.
Same geometry as before.
Yeah. Exactly. So this same geometry can be used to compute one at least one loop calculation. Higher loop, it's, we should be more careful about the geometry we're correcting.
Sorry, which diagram?
It's a one-loop diagram, scalar field, gravitons, and gauge field, all matter fields in gravity. Yeah, including gravity, yes. Okay. So any other questions?
So what do you mean about entanglement entropy? Do you mean entanglement between the
two regions, yeah. So exactly. We just have, for example, in ADS space time, we have some Poincaré metric. We just cut it this way, A and B, and just talk about entanglement between these two regions, as we do exactly in quantum field theory. So that only gives this contribution, and we are missing some this kind of topological contribution. So that is captured by this world director. Okay. So now I'd like to give an explicit calculation in a higher dimensional case. I already give some example in lower dimensional case. So I'd like to generalize this calculation into higher dimension. Now we have this explained derivation. So in 2D, I mean 2D CFT divided to three-dimensional gravity, we know they already answer. But because the 2D CFT has a large, very large symmetry, it's Virasoro symmetry, so that we can determine the complete shape, complete form of entanglement entropy. But in higher dimension, it's quite difficult. More or less, conformal invariance is not so helpful to fix the form, to fix the coefficient, for example, of this entanglement entropy in general. So it's quite useful to use AdS CFT to calculate entanglement entropy, especially in higher dimensions. So I just some examples. So we are talking about AdS d plus 2 divided to CFT d plus 1. And so there are two analytical examples. We can get some analytical expressions. First one is some strip shape. Another one, so this is strip shape with some finite width L, and this is extended to infinity, so we can just write it A, L, and this subsystem is here. Another one is some ball, spherical ball, round ball, which is like this, and the subsystem A, the radius of subsystem A is some width defined to be L here. So for these, we can have some explicit calculations. So first, this strip case. So this area, so we can just compute this area so that so we have this boundary, and this is a experiment z direction and x direction here. And I just maybe just set it to x1. And the minimal surface takes this shape, and in this infinite direction, it's just transverse direction. This is just transverse direction. And we want to specify the shape of this manifold, say z equals zx, this function. So assuming this ansatz, we have that area is determined this way. So here it's L, it's that means this L over 2, and it's minus L. So you can just have this integral. This is to D. We just compute this induced metric here and just compute this area. And we want to claim this area should be minimized. But for this system, because this expression does not have any expressed x dependence, we can have a sort of Hamiltonian. Assuming, interpreting this x is some time direction. So we have very this is a simple example, and so that we have we find some integral, and in the end, this means that we can have just instead of second order, but just first order differential equation. It's like xzd and z star to d minus z to d. Z star is an integration constant, or Hamiltonian energy of this, which is constant and independent of x. So just we put it z star, and exactly this z star is this turning point, as is clear from this expression. So we just solve this by integrating this. And so we find, so this dz is dx dz. And we integrate from 0 to z star. So we integrate this along this line. And we find this. And it's just this elementary integral. And we can exactly calculate this in terms of some gamma function. So z star and L is actually linear each other. So L is some size of the system. And indeed, z star, z is interpreted as energy scale, or length scale of the dual field theory in AdSFT. This is consistent with this. And in the end, this entropy, which is just calculated as an area divided by 4g Newton, this area is this area. And we plug this expression here, this solution here. So it's like, I'm not sure I should write details, but it's like, just to, for completeness, I just write it. And some constant well, I'm not sure you're interested in this constant, but just to for complication, I just d or something, some numerical value which depend on d. But anyway, so this is a final result for this strip shape subsystem. So you may notice that only two terms. And the first term is already we know, this is area row term. And second term is more interesting. This is some finite, but negative at this finite term. Finite term. And so in principle, if we could compute this quantity in quantum field theory side, conformal field theory, we can just directly compare this quantity so that it agrees with each other. But this term is a bit subtle because it depends on the cutoff, and we have to specify how to choose cutoff. It's a bit ambiguous quantity. But roughly speaking, we can estimate degree of freedom, like the RD divided by G Newton is again proportional to the degree of freedom. So this is a situation in this strip case. I come back to the later about n equal 4 Yamets case. But here just I write it. Next one is this ball, round ball, especially with particular radius. In this case, we can do the same thing like this. But this case is slightly naively, it looks harder because there are no conserved quantity. But in this case, it's so symmetric that we can easily find the answer. So the way to find the answer is first we can look at just subsystem, just line, half line, and we just divide AB. In this case, minimal surface is very simple, just extend it this way in Poincaré radius. And then we do conformal mapping of this map, of this infinite line. So then it's, this is a famous fact that this hyperplane maps to this round sphere here by conformal mapping. And then we can, at the same time, we know how to do the conformal mapping in AdS side. So we can just do this coordinate transformation to find the correct minimal surface. I don't do this in detail, but in the end, this minimal surface is just given a very simple one, which is just a half sphere. So we have this. So we have this region A here. And the minimal surface is just half of the sphere. If we add half, then it's just sphere. It's like this is L, and this is also L. This is the direction. It's very simple minimal surface. So this case, we can again estimate this area. So area turns out to be the following shape. So I can just write induced symmetric here, R square and d square R is this radial direction. This radial direction. And so you have this polar coordinate and this time direction and z direction. But time dimension, we fix time here, so we don't, this problem is not important. And so this angular direction we can trivially integrate out. And this gives volume of sphere for assuming this sphere is a unit radius. And we have a scaling about this R, RD. And we have some L. dz, some integral here. So you can just plug this expression here and just compute a little bit, then you get this integral. So basically, we can expand this part in terms of L to d minus 2. We assume L is very large, so L to d minus 2, and some term times d minus 4. And d square and so on. It's an expansion of d square. We can do this exactly, but just we are interested in result. So we just take 4 g newton divided by this area. And compute this thing. Yeah, so this I had a little bit longer, maybe. I should switch to another block. So basically, we just expand in terms of this z square and integrate about z. And in the end, what we find, just we do this calculation. And as you can see easily, leading term is a dz, integral of z about 1 over z d inverse, 1 over zd. So it gives a d minus 1 power. So the leading term is like this, d minus 1. And it's a d square expansion, so you have some L epsilon and d minus 3 appears and continue. But then final point is important and depending on the dimension. So when d plus 1, total space dimension is even, in this case, it ends up with some logarithmic term. So we just write q log of L by epsilon, some constant, but this constant is not important, not interesting, because if we change the epsilon slightly, so this constant also shifted. But this coefficient doesn't change, even if we scale epsilon a little bit, but still this Q is universal. On the other hand, D plus 1 is odd, then you get a constant term. So we have some linear divergence. This index is, P, some linear divergence. Plus some constant. And this is again universal in that because this constant is independent from this epsilon. If you scale epsilon, still this term is there and just pick up this. So this part, this first of all, this Q is related to this logarithmic term. And logarithmic behavior is typical to this conformal anomaly. So this is related to central charge. I will come to this point more detail later. So this is a central charge, some linear combination of central charge. On the other hand, this PD is some analog of central charge, but this is auto dimension, and there are non-conformal anomaly. But still, entanglement entropy is a good measure to estimate this degree of freedom. And this quantity actually recently called something like F quantity. F comes from free energy, F. But this is a nice quantity, some analog of central charge, which measures degree of freedom for this odd-dimensional conformal field theory. So this is a general structure of entanglement entropy. And for example, this is actually, we assume that already because we assume this round sphere, and that this kind of expansion, this kind of behavior with different coefficient true for any smooth shape of subsystem A in conformal field theory. But then one may think about some this kind of cusp-like configuration, cusp-like subsystem. Then you, for example, in this case, you get some middle term, like L to epsilon to D minus 2. So this kind of term is related to this cusp angle somehow. But if we are smooth, then it's like L square power. It's expanded 1 over L square power. OK, so this is a general structure of entanglement. Any question? Yes, OK. OK, so now I give some express example of n equal 4 units. So this. So in the n equal 4 units case, it's radius of AdS. AdS radius is 4 pi G string. So G string is a string coupling constant, and alpha prime is a square of string length. This is very stringy quantity. And by using this, and also we can use this Newton constant in 5D. It comes from Newton constant 10D. Spring theory is defined in 10 dimension. We just do some causal Klein compactification, which means just we have volume factor. So we have in mind ADS5 cross S5 dual to 4D and equal 4 super amuse. My gauge group is SUN. So just volume of this part appears here. And in the end, by using this, now it's twice the Newton. This 10 is 10 dimension, and this 5 dimension. So in the end, we can find that this SA for this strip I just added S. So we find that this entropy takes much more simpler form. This n is the rank of gauge group, 2 pi epsilon square. This is a cutoff. This is area of divergence. And 2 root pi, something like that. 1/16. This is a constant, huh? This is a strip result, and this part is approximate. We can just numerically approximate. This is minus 0.05 minus square L square L small L square. And of course, this result is a gravity result, and we cannot directly compare this result with field theory, which we normally do in a weakly coupling limit. But we can still try this comparison. Strongly coupled gauge theory is quite difficult to analyze, but we can just try this for this free field analysis of gauge theory. So this is supposed to be strongly coupled. And if we do the calculation for free Young mu's, just a purely quantum field theory viewpoint, we exactly got the same functional shape, but slightly different coefficient here. I think in our paper we find this is 0.08, like this. But then, of course, this is not contradiction. This coefficient depends on the coupling constant of this Young-Mutz gauge theory. But this is a relatively nice semi-quantitative agreement.
Excuse me, what is big L?
Big L is, okay. Big L is this length of this. This slip and this length is there. The small L is a radius. This is the most important parameter. But this is infinite. But we want to just cut it out. this idea. Yeah, I'm not sure, but this is also very famous example of this entropy, thermal entropy agreement. So this thermal entropy computed weakly coupled, just free LMU theory, and also we can compare it to strongly coupled result in gravity. And they agree up to this famous 4 3 or 4 factor. It is some analog of that, but not exactly the same. There are no reason we expect the same thing, exactly the same thing, but some analog. So this is only special for, I think, n equal 4 minutes. But actually, this is more another one. This says the round sphere is more interesting. We can have a nice precise agreement. So this round one. So this case, this is a round ball just like B. In this case, we have, again, we have, of course, this area of divergence. But we have some logarithmic term, which is like coefficient minus n square log L over epsilon, and some constant. So this is some precise value. Compared with this, it's much simpler value. And indeed, this is interpreted as minus 4 times A. A is the central charge of this four-dimensional conformal field theory. And we know that in n equal 4 years, precisely A is n squared. Actually, n equals minus 1 for SUN, but it is almost same as in the large unit, it's just approximated n squared over 4. So in this case, we have a precise agreement because this term, as already mentioned, is proportional to central charge, and central charge is independent from coupling constant. So it is, we may wonder what's the precise relation about this coefficient of this logarithmic term and central charge or conformal number. This is something I'd like to quickly mention. Next. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, indeed, in the end, so you find exactly this part is just proportional to A. So this is this gives a minus n square times divided by central charge of n equal 4 and some central charge of this dual gauge theory which you like. Maybe you have in n equal 1, then exactly, we can just confirm this also. Yeah. Okay, so now I'd like to also mention that more definite relation to this conformal anomaly. So, but this is actually can be done by following observation. So we take, anyway, entanglement entropy depends on size of subsystem, the size of subsystem. And we take derivative L and we multiply. This is a scale transformation. And if we do the scale transformation, if there are no conformal anomaly, we have, this is just, we confirm this is to be vanishing because there is a scale invariance in conformal field theory, but there is an anomaly. This is measured by energy stress, a trace part of energy stress tensor. So we have the derivative of n. This is just a replica method. I have in mind just a replica method here. Minus sign here. I have in mind the replica method, and sigma n is a n-sheeted Riemann surface. Or it's higher dimensional version of that. And we have some metric and the stress anomaly is proportional to the trace of this energy stress sensor. And we evaluate this in CFT. So this is a general formula which is applied to this entanglement entropy under this scale transformation. So in 2D CFT, we can just, we know that there are famous formula about trace anomaly, which is like 12, yeah, times R. This R is a rich curvature, rich scalar on this n-sheeted Riemann surface, which we often have. Fine. Here. And we evaluated it. So this, and because for n-sheeted Riemann surface, we already mentioned that it gives some contribution, delta function contribution to this rich scalar. So it gives to this is an Euler number. It gives something like that. So each point, each this singularity gives to 4 pi. As I wrote it, 1 over n and delta function. So we have 2, so it's a, and divided by 4 pi, you have some 2 here. And combine between this, and we can just compute LDSA and DL. And this turns out to be, as we expect, 3 divided by C. So we just plug here, and we plug this here. And with some proper normalization, we find this C over 3. So this means just we just confirm previous formula. This formula, which already yesterday I proved this, but we just confirm this formula. So this is 2D, so nothing so interesting. So now we switch to 4D. So for this CFT, and there, again, there is a famous formula of this energy stress part of energy stress tensor, which looks like this. There are two terms because there are two central charges. So W is a wild curvature. So it's contracted with intra-index. A is another, C is one central charge, another central charge is called A. So this is a dual of this. So this is an Euler characteristic. And this is a wild curvature square. And so entanglement entropy is supposed to have some areal divergence. So it's like L square, epsilon square, and some constant, which I don't know, which I'm not talking about. Some Q, which we already defined. This is supposed to be somehow universal, L divided by some other constant. So now, by using this formula, and we just plug this formula here, and we just evaluate this quantity, slightly complicated quantity, on this higher dimensional version of this linear n-seated Riemann surface, we can get the following result. This is very complicated, and I don't show, I'm sorry for that, I cannot show details. It's quite a complicated calculation, which is, by this paper by Sorodkin, I just write the number of here, and also Myers and the collaborators. So if you are interested, just look at this paper. But the result looks like Hollen formula. Q, there is a simpler term. This is actually easy to derive. This is proportional to the central charge called A. Now it's entangling surface. This boundary of A. We have A, and its boundary A is now two dimension. We are talking about four dimensional conformal fusel, and subsystem is three dimension, and the boundary of subsystem is two dimension. So this two dimension, and we just integrate over this curvature R. This is Euler number, just Euler number of this two dimensional Riemann surface. And there are about other part, which is related to this C, central charge of C. And so W, A, B, C, D, H is the induced, sorry, I write it G, but maybe it is good to write H here. It's H is the induced metric on this boundary of A. This is H, A, C, and B, D, H, B, D. This is some wild scale. This comes from this part, roughly. It is easy. But there are some more complicated contributions, which is like extrinsic curvature. Extrinsic curvature of this surface embedded in this space-time. It's like we write it to K. K is the extrinsic curvature. And something like that, square here. So this is a formula, full formula of this. And one can easily understand that A is originally is a topological origin. This is a proportional Euler character. It's really topological, and indeed it induces a topological one. And this C is related to wild curvature, and indeed it's involved this wild curvature. So but we can just see how we can apply this formula. So this case, we can just, for example, look at this case, this S2. So you have A and its round sphere, its boundary round sphere S2. In this case, because it's round sphere, it's symmetric sphere, this part drops out. It's a sphere is a some conformal flat. This part is everything drops out and we just have this term. And as you know, Euler number of sphere is just 2. This part is 2, 4 pi. Right? So we have minus 4a canceling out. And this is exactly what we had here. But this is purely conformal field theory. Exactly. Okay, so any question? So now I switch to auto-dimensional case. In auto-dimensional case, we don't have conformal anomaly, but still we have this final part of entanglement entropy. And the argument, which are considered by this paper, is by Cassini and Fritz Myers. I don't get into the detail, but just this is some precise relation, precise interpretation of entanglement entropy, just I write it here. So the argument is that we have some considering flat space-time, Minkowski space-time, and we talk about entanglement entropy. But there is, because we are looking at conformal field theory, we can do some conformal map. And we can conformal map to Doshita space, D plus 1D. So we are talking about this entangling region A. This is a subsystem A. We are talking about entanglement for this subsystem A and the other part. And for this, we particularly choose this subsystem A is again round ball. And then this light cone, which covered here. This is a sort of horizon, Lindner horizon for this observer, which is situated in this region A. And this under this map, conformal map, we find that actually this is Doshita space, which is a Penrose diagram of Doshita space-time. And this light cone, this two light cone part is coincide with this light cone in Doshita space. This is Doshita space Penrose diagram, this region. So in that sense, this is something people call Doshita horizon. So now we map this just calculation of entanglement entropy to some just calculation of sort of Doshita entropy. Doshita entropy, but in quantum field theory sense. So by using this map, this shows that following simple equality. So this shows that we compute entanglement entropy for region A. But this is interpreted as thermodynamical entropy in Doshita space. I just said it. Thermodynamical entropy in Doshita space. Doshita space has a horizon and that means we have some temperature here, and we have some thermodynamical entropy corresponding to that. And then we can slightly talk more about this. And this entropy is, of course, in terms of this thermodynamical entropy, so this is interpreted as free energy and energy. So this energy in Doshita space minus energy in free energy in Doshita space. This is standard thermodynamical rule. And then let's assume d plus 1 dimension is odd. This odd dimensional conformal field theory, which we are looking at here. And then we can show there are no vacuum energy somehow. This is prohibited by the rotating space-time symmetry of this Doshita space. Doshita space is a maximally symmetric space. And this really excludes this vacuum energy. So because of that, what we find is something like this shape. This simple relation here. So, and this Doshita entropy is now, already I explained, it is like related to entanglement entropy. So in this way, so this entanglement entropy for this region A, which is a round ball, is now interpreted as a free energy in Doshita space. And also this minus beta F is, as we know, it's a log of partition function in Doshita space. But here, we have to do this Euclidean continuation because we are talking about thermodynamics. We have to replace this real time, Lorentzian time, with imaginary time, which is standard procedure to deal with finite temperature physics. So if we do this weak rotation of time for this Doshita space, it becomes just sphere, this d plus 1. So sphere, d plus 1 dimensional sphere. So in this language, it's very simple relation that entanglement entropy for this setup is just partition function on sphere.
Where is the A dependence?
A dependence, you mean radius dependence? A is fixed to be particular shape actually here. Only we allow this round
right.
shape.
Radius
depends on this Doshita, for example, radius.
Same radius.
Roughly speaking.
It's not invariant under conformal mapping, or it is?
It's invariant. Of course. We are talking about quantity in a conformal field theory. Right. So, for example, the expression we had like this, we have some power right here. Right? We have some area of divergence, it's some power of L over epsilon. And conformal transformation just multiply some factor for length scale L, and at the same time also epsilon. This, under this transformation is invariant. If we look at some finite piece, it's independent of epsilon, right? Then just invariant under just scale transformation of the standard quantity. And so this is somehow people call F quantity, which people use as some analog of central with some sign different. This is defined. I think in a paper by Klebanov and collaborators. But there are interesting activity in this direction. But just for completeness, I mention this interpretation. So now I basically finished the basic calculation of this holographic entanglement entropy and its interpretation from the viewpoint of conformal field theory and conformal anomaly. So and I would like to switch to some more advanced topic and just for 30 minutes and just finish my talk. So it's a good time. If you have any question, it is a good time to ask.
Why is the decision map not possible for even
dimensions? That's possible. That's possible, but that is possible, but we cannot use this fact. This is a sort of Kashimiya energy, and it has a proportional centralization anomaly. Yeah. So this relation only holds in odd dimension. Yeah. Okay. Any other question? Okay, so let me switch to the slide. epsilon. Epsilon, to prove epsilon is something different. I mean, of course, we can do it in a holographical way, like Rob Myers and collaborator did before. And also, there are ways to derive three-dimensional epsilon by using strong subadditivity. That is done Cassini and Felter. But in higher dimension, we don't 5D or 7D, we don't have a proof from field theory side. But the holography side, yes. OK. So first, I'd like to thank you very much. First, I'd quickly mention this phase transition. So so far, we only discussed this entanglement entropy in conformal field theory, but this sometimes have some mass gap. And especially in a gauge theory viewpoint, the basic mass gap comes from this confinement behavior. So here I just explain this. And this is a quick modification of what we did for AdS space-time. This is AdS space-time, but it's actually infrared regions capped off. So we don't have some region. We are missing region in the infrared. That means there is a missing degree of freedom in the deep IR. That means that we have some mass gap in AdS CFT. This kind of qualitative behavior is always true in AdS CFT correspondence. And because of that, what kind of effect can we have? That is a question we'd like to ask. And we again take this strip-like shape of the subsystem A, and we change the value of L, small L. And the minimal surface extended from this boundary. And this background, which we particularly looking at so-called AdS soliton, which already appeared in previous lectures, it just come from some double weak rotation of this black hole, AdS black hole solution. This AdS black hole solution, I just replace t, time, with some other coordinate x1, space direction, and we t goes to ix, and x goes to it, and then we just flip this way. And then, instead of horizon, we have some cap of geometry. So at the originally horizon point, this circle shrinks down like this. And in this geometry, again, there are no some infrared degree of freedom. So we can, and people understand this as some holographic dual of this confining gauge theory. Yeah, this is, of course, yeah. This is a solution to Einstein equation, you know, just vacuum Einstein equation, because this is solution, the AdS black hole is a solution to vacuum Einstein equation. So we are using this geometry and compute entanglement entropy. There are two competing contributions. One is that this connected surface, which already looking at many places in previous calculations. So this is a two boundary of this strip shape subsystem, and it's connected this 2 point. But in the AdS soliton, it is also possible to some disconnected surface from this 2 point, to these two boundaries. So it's extended to the from the infinity, this is a AdS boundary, to some point. To this point is just a really gapped point, this capped off point. And it just ended it. This kind of geometry is allowed here. So these two contributions actually compete. And minimal surface, which connected minimal surfaces gives non-trivial effect, non-trivial result. We plot this finite part of entanglement entropy here. And this is a width of subsystem. So it goes to my, this is much like just pure AdS result. It's non-trivially increasing. But at this point, it's there are no solution. So for larger L, there are no solution. And even before that, there's a phase transition to this disconnected surface. This disconnected surface is this green line. It always stays the same. But this connected one go this way, and just stop here, and just switch to this disconnected one. So from this, by changing air, this changes air is sort of changing temperature, effective temperature. But here we are working on zero temperature geometry, but still we can introduce some energy scale by changing the size of subsystem air, and we see this some sort of phase transition here, and this is understood, can be identified with confinement, the confinement phase transition. Yeah, so we can also, there are some lattice calculation done a few years ago. So we can see the similar behavior, but they are doing the calculation for finite and gauge theory, SU3 or SU2. So it's a slightly looks like smooth. It's not so sharp, this kind of sharp transition here. It's a derivative jumps, but here it looks slightly smooth, but still you can see some analog of this, some gap here. So this is a, so the, I mean, qualitatively, this result in lattice calculation is consistent with holographic calculation.
By the way, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Is the critical temperature same?
It's different. Because here we only define something analog temperature by L. We don't have temperature is always zero, this calculation, but analog temperature is 1 over L. But it's slightly different. So we don't qualitatively same, but it's quantitatively it's not comparable, I think. Okay, so this I finished this, my explanation of holographic entanglement entropy, and I'd like to switch to a different recent progress, but which is closely related to the calculation of entanglement entropy. So which is, this is so this is something called entanglement minimization or MERA. So this MERA is some numerical calculation method to deal with some continuum system, to deal with quantum critical points. But the structure, it was as pointed by this swinger here, and its structure is quite similar to AdS CFT, this AdS space-time. And as we come back, as we explain later, so there, if we take into account the viewpoint of entanglement and entanglement entropy, we can see that this connection more closely. So this basic motivation is that, we'd like to find some relation between metric of this holographic dual geometry and some original wave function in conformal field theory or some quantum manifold systems. If you have conformal field state or some more generally some quantum manifold system, you have some ground state wave function psi, and from here it is direct to calculate entanglement entropy, just von Neumann entropy. And you can choose any subsystem A. And from here, we know that this entanglement entropy is the same as this area of minimal surface. And on the other hand, if you know the metric, it is direct to compute minimal area surface. So in this way, if we know about entanglement for any A, so maybe we can reproduce a metric here. So this is a basic idea here. And if we want to do this kind of connection, the one good candidate of this framework is something called entanglement minimization, or MERA, which is first constructed by Jeffrey Vidal, 2005. So this is something I'd like to introduce as my final part of my lecture. So tensor network, so recently there have been remarkable progresses in numerical calculation of quantum lattice model by using the method generally called tensor product state. So this leads to various nice variational answers for ground state of very complicated quantum variable systems. But people learn that answers of this quantum ground state wave function is good if it respects the basic property of quantum entanglement of real ground state. So we should, for example, entanglement entropy should agree with each other between this ansatz and this true ground state. So this is a basic structure of this tensor network. So here, this is some three vertices is written here, and we just this call some matrix M. So alpha beta is indexed in this direction, in this 2 points, and the sigma is a spin here. Here we have in mind some up down spin here, in mind, and we just combine this in the matrix. And then the very famous numerical approach to this 1D, especially 1D ground state wave function of this quantum system is called matrix product state, or also called DMRG. There the ansatz, basic ansatz is like this, written in this diagram. So basic ansatz is written in this diagram. So this is a spin. So spin chain, we have some spin chain which we'd like to find ground state, and this spin state. We have up down here, and but we connect this way, and this we couple this three joint vertex here, and if we attach these two vertex and attach to here, that means we trace out this index, and this index alpha runs from 1 to chi. Chi is some integer, which is rather different from the spin, and so this contraction means that we just multiply this matrix M sigma with each other, and finally we contract again, that means taking trace. And we specify this coefficient of this spin state by this matrix product value. And then it turns out that, of course, M is an infinite dimensional matrix, so this gives a precise answer. But we just truncate, assume some approximation so that the size of matrix M is finite size. But still, people find it's quite a nice approximation in some gapped systems. So this is heavily used technique. But here we are interested in conformal field theory, which is a coordinate critical point, which is a coordinate critical point. There, actually, this kind of approximation is not always good. But still, we can do, but theoretically, somehow, there should be some better formalism. And this can be, this factor can be seen from the estimation of this entanglement entropy. So we can write down this diagram, the same one, same as previous one. And we just call this subsystem A just these spins. And we trace out this spin, and there are infinitely other actually extended here, but we just trace out the other part and we'll pick up this region A. Then entanglement entropy is actually estimated by this counting number of bonds which some curve which surround this region A, and it's intersect, so we just count number of intersection points. Because this region is entangled with others by only through this connection. So this we have 2 points, that means 2 times log chi. Chi is a degree of freedom for each line, each bond. So it's 2 times log chi is the maximum amount of entanglement entropy, which can be carried by this subsystem A. But this is a finite amount. But actually, we want a much more larger entanglement because we want to somehow realize some quantum critical point where this entanglement entropy scales like log L. This large L, or previously we write it small L, is a length of this subsystem A. It's a logarithmic law, which we explain. So if we assume this region A is very large, then it is easy to over. This value is just a very small value to reproduce this correct entanglement entropy. So this is not so good answer, unless if you take chi to be very large. So that's why here we'd like to take this chi to finite, so then this is not something good. So then we can also switch to this another diagram like this, this tree diagram. But then still we have a problem that we just talk about this intersection point like this. We just this subsystem A and just surrounded by some curve and just talk about intersecting point which connects these two regions. Just only two again. So this is not whole useful. So how can we do? So this is a next question, but this is nicely resolved by considering framework called MERA, which is multi-scale entanglement minimization ansatz. This is an efficient variational ansatz to find some conformal field theory ground state, and which has quite recently developed. So this is some tree diagram, tree tensor network, which I just mentioned. But instead of this, we can consider slightly more complicated, but it's actually simple rule. We just add some radars in each level. We just add some radar in each level. So this radar means that we have some two spins and we combine into one. This diagram shows. This is a coarse graining procedure. This is typical in renormalization group flow. But at the same time, we do some unitary transformation between these two spins and the other two spins. So we do some unitary transformation for these two spins, and we get some to other spins here. So this is this procedure, some S matrix procedure here, and we have this kind of, we can put this radar in this way. So then we can do the same thing for higher tower here, and we can estimate entanglement entropy. So then we have some, this is a coarse graining procedure, so we have some 2n spins, then next level we have n spins and one more than n over 2 spin appears. In that way, roughly we estimate if we have some subsystem A which is length is larger, then if we go to the log L in this direction, then it ends up almost it disappears. This site it disappears. So and at the same time we can just counting number of bonds or intersecting bonds which intersect with this curve and this between this curve and also this radar called disentangler. This is this at entanglement, and from this side it's we cut it out entanglement. So these people call disentangler, but from this side it's somehow entangled. So we counting number of this intersection points anyway. So then it scales a log L because this direction is length of this direction is log L. So this agree with what roughly agree with what we expect for conformal fusel ground state. This agree with to the CFT. So this is the one good reason why we have nice result for the looking at this mirror approach to find the ground state wave function for this conformal fusel. So then this structure, one may notice that this structure is very similar to anti-Doshita space. So this is a higher dimensional version of this one. So in good point of this mirror approach, you can just increase the dimension. So then, so we have this kind of structure. This is a first state. This is the original spin system, some quantum variable system. The second part is some coarse-grained one, and one more coarse-grained one. In the end, it just disappeared here. We just combine two spin to one, two spin to one, and so on. So there, that we can just estimate the entanglement entropy for this region A, and between this region A and the other part B. So then, basically, as we already noticed that entanglement entropy is estimated as the number of bonds which intersect with this surface which end on this boundary of A. This is just surrounded, this surface surrounds this region A, and just counting number of bonds, because that this through this bond, this region is entangled with each, the other part in just this quantum variable language. So this picture is very similar to this our picture of this holographic calculation of entanglement entropy. But furthermore, here there are many different kinds of surfaces possible, right? We can just surround the region A in many, infinitely many different ways. But anyway, we have to, in that case, we have to minimize this bond so that we optimize the result. Otherwise, we somehow overcount entangling bonds. So this minimization procedure is very similar to this minimization of this area of this calculation of entanglement entropy. Yeah, of course, this is just a qualitative agreement or a qualitative similarity, but it's quite interesting to see the connection between them. And indeed, this Brian Swinger claims that this one interpretation of this AdS CFT correspondence is precisely this entanglement renormalization, this mirror. And indeed, if we look at some matching between this coordinate between them, and it's some nice agreement. So this metric of this space-time, this Poincaré space-time is like this. And we do this coordinate transformation like this way. And we introduce something called U. U is just a layer, and label is a layer. This first layer, we just call U equals 0. And second layer, we call U equals minus 1. This is some funny way to label, but just some convenience for my side. So that's, in the end, we got U goes to minus infinity. And this U is related to this normal coordinate, standard extra dimension z by this formula. And the mirror looks like this metric. So this is these are quite discretized picture. But recently, there are some continuous version of this mirror, which is called continuous mirror, constructed by these people. And there, we just represent this ground state wave function in terms of some, you know, infinitely many action of this coarse graining and also this disentangler, so adding some entanglement to this ground state. So we start with some omega state, which is an infrared state, and this state is very special state in that there are no entanglement. There are no entanglement between two sides, any real space entanglement. And we add entanglement by putting this operation called K. K is a disentangler. Some add some entanglement and also do some scale transformation, coarse graining, in the opposite of coarse graining, which we call L. And in the end, we do this path ordering formalism. And we reproduce this correct ground state. So this is a construction of this ground state wave function called this continuous mirror. But this is just a continuous version of this kind of mirror approach. So the natural conjecture is that d plus one dimensional this continuous mirror should be equivalent to some gravity on anti-Doshita space-time. So for this we a little bit worked on this about this metric, and we So this work with Nozaki and Shinseryu last year. So this we try to work out so how to calculate metric in this framework of CMERA, especially about this extra dimension. So we know, of course, we know there's some metric of this conformal field theory, but the AdS CFT says that there is some one more extra dimension, and we could be able to some compute this metric in this direction. And one natural candidate of this metric, we argue, is this one. This GUU is a, U is a, this extra dimension, this direction, this layer, as I told you, it's a layer U. U is a layer direction, and these are almost related to Z direction in this coordinate map. So but this shape comes from the, this GUU, we want to compute GUU in the metric in U direction, and this metric and that come from the some quantum information, something called quantum information metric or called breadth metric. We can just measure the distance between two different quantum states. So we just basically we measure the distance between two layers. So this part, after we have this entangler procedure, we have some state here, and we have before that we have some state. We just measure this difference between these two states and by this measure, this distance. And this precisely corresponds to the number of these disentanglers. And number of disentangler is related to area because of this holographic entanglement entropy. So entanglement entropy is the integral of this metric, which is this area. And this metric and this entropy, this number of bonds contributes, so there should be direct relation between them. And this is a reason why we find this formula. This psi u is some wave function of it's energy scale u, and u plus du is a slightly shifted energy wave function, and we just compute the distance between them. By using this, for example, you can, so we can just look at particular free scalar field theory, so that we can, this is a toy model because it's free scalar field theory, free model, but we can compute this metric exactly, and in the end, for example, so this is our ansatz of metric. We want to compute this GUU, and this metric is related to something called chi u, which is some function appears here. This k is a disentangler, and written in terms of creation operator of this scalar field. And this, we can compute explicitly this metric, and in the end, if you take this massless scalar case, we can reproduce anti-Dositta space metric. And also, if we talk about some non-relativistic but scale-invariant theory, it's a Lifshitz theory, then we have some it is consistent with Lifshitz metric, and if we have massive scalar field, mass perturbation, then the metric is deformed from this anti-Dositta space. Instead, we get some cap of geometry as expected, like area Sueton geometry. And so we can also talk about some excitation of the theory, which you, so this is called quantum quenching. This is explained in the Professor Bashin's talk. And this is a excitation of the theory. I don't have enough time, I just show the result. So we can excite the theory, and we can compute the metric by induced by these excitations. And people expect some sort of black hole formation in the end, but at least we can say that some metric evolves dynamically in this setup, and we can see this explicitly in this plot. So we plot this our calculated value of this metric, induced metric, in an extra dimension after this quantum quench. It's like propagation of gravitational waves. So this is the waves, and this is an extra dimension z, and this time evolution. So here we quench the system, and this effect propagates almost within a right cone. Not exactly, but this is a free field approach, so it's almost a right cone. And this propagation of this gravitational waves, and we can also estimate the entanglement entropy growth about time, and indeed we can confirm this linear increasement of entanglement entropy, which is shown in 2D by Calabres-Cardi, by conformal field theory method. But in recently, Hartmann and Maldacena actually proved this behavior even for higher dimension, and our result also consistent with that result. Our method can be used to higher dimension. Okay, so finally, just one comment that this is quite ambitious direction, but we can talk about what is some holographic dual of flat space time. If we just naively do that, we get this kind of result. So we can just, in our setup, we can talk about this metric GUU to exponential 2U. Then we, our metric is almost the same as flat space time. Then we have some language how to interpret this metric in terms of this C-mera and see what kind of theory have this kind of ground state as a gauge theory side. So we can just, from this input, this flat space input, flat space metric in the gravity side, we can compute this function, something we, I just call chi u. But anyway, so in the end, what we find is this very funny dispersion relation. So this means that if we want to realize some flat space metric, then we have to consider this kind of highly non-local Hamiltonian. So this is something, I mean, basic result, and that if we look at conformal field theory, and it's a quite local theory, then we have some anti-Doshita space. But if we want to go beyond from that limit, like the flat space or Doshita space, we have to think about this kind of quite highly non-local theory, which you're not completely familiar with. Yeah, so this is final point, and I think I'll stop here. Thank you very much.
Yeah, exactly.
Because we have some calculation metric, right? In terms of field theory data, we can reverse it easily. And we just input this metric of this gravity background, then inevitably we have this dispersion relation, which is really highly non-local.
So maybe I ask some simple questions. Sort of, I mean, your conjecture that basically sort of this matrix product states, I mean, are equivalent to some sort of AdS metric is based then in the end on saying, well, I calculated for this simple example, and then I see it agrees sort of with some known results? Or, I mean, is there anything more than?
Yeah, so basically, but I mean, by using this approach, we could prove, for example, this.
So you get the linear scale.
Yeah, linear, exactly. So this entanglement.
Basically,
based on this. That's
right. There is no, at the moment, further.
No, I mean, definite proof from just standard field theory calculation. Yeah.
Yeah.
Any thoughts on how this
Kind of
conjecture connection would work at non-zero temperature?
Actually, it's quite, I mean, technically complicated to lift this kind of calculation in finite temperature. Actually, we are actually one of them, I mean, current project for us is to work out this kind of mirror structure at finite temperature, see mirror structure in finite. It's a bit complicated than usual. So I, at this at present, I cannot comment more than that. But it's quite a very interesting problem.
Can you go back to this formula for this chi uu? Because I mean, basically, you're comparing wave functions at different scales, u and u plus u. But of course, we have integrated out.
Yeah.
Because you have integrated out degrees of freedom. So I mean, in a way, what kind of overlap do you? Because I mean, the e to the l du.
This is something. This is something. Simple actually. What we'd like to do, so we have some this kind of structure. So we have some spin here, and we do some procedure called disentangler. So this mix it, and we again
building block spins.
Thank you. So with this, this is not something here. So I add. So with this, and then this, and. So what we do is to compare this state, for example, this state. So because we want to compare this state with another state, because we just want to counting number of this disentanglers, this increases number of entanglement. If we compute entanglement entropy between this region and this region, then we just counting number of intersecting bonds. So this is an integral, and holography says that this is the integral of this area. This metric. So we just want to counting number of this bone, and which is density. And to do that, we just compare these two different states and compute distance between. But at the same time, we have to worry about the presence of coarse graining. And so if we compare this state with this state, then we have also coarse graining procedure. This is something we don't want. So we put an additional factor, this LDU, to remove it.
Let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.